weekend to everyone. I know this is the time of year where we kick off our first, you know, barbecues and things like that, although it's really cold outside. Super windy and supposed to be cold, which is so weird, the weather. But I do want to take a second, and just because it is Memorial Day weekend and we're having fun and we're partying, just take a second to remember that Memorial Day is all about those who have given up their lives so that we could have ours. Amen. So this weekend, think about that and consider, you know, just say a prayer. We can even do it right now. Father, bless the families of all those who have people who have given up loved ones. Lord, we ask that you would bless them and minister to them and be with them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I introduced myself already as Tiffany when I welcomed you just a second ago. But my name's Tiffany, in case you didn't catch that. And my husband Elliot and I have the great honor of being able to pastor this group of people called Lifeline Church. And we love being here every Sunday. It's our favorite. We look forward to Sunday because it's so much fun. So I'm happy to be with you all today. We are in a series called Frequently Asked Questions. And the series has been all about answering some of the questions, just like it sounds, that we've been frequently asked. And so, you know, we've answered church questions and people questions. And if you missed anything, you can go back and check us out on YouTube or on Facebook. Or even the website, you can find the videos on there as well. So today, what we're going to talk about is how do I share my faith? How do I share my faith? We've heard that question before, and so we're going to answer it. And I think we're going to have a lot of fun. And what's really cool is that this is so much simpler than maybe you think it is. And so it's going to be really encouraging today. A few years ago, I was someone was sharing a part of their story with me. They were telling me about a family member of theirs. And the person they were telling me about was someone who maybe you've had an experience like this. So a person is telling me a story about one of their family members, and this family member should have been someone who loved them and encouraged them and spoke life into them and cared for them and protected them. But instead, you know, they're telling me about how this person had treated them, and I was like, you know, have you ever been in a situation where someone is talking about their life or their story and you just feel sorry? Like, man, that's not how your life should have gone. That's not who you are. They told me about how, you know, this person, instead of loving them and caring for them, was always talking down to them. And instead of protecting them, was abusing them. And instead of guarding them, you know what I mean? Just a story like that. And I remember thinking, gosh, that's not how your life was supposed to go, and that's not who you are. But because you've been raised that way, you believe something about yourself that's not true. You believe a lot of things about yourself that aren't true, but my God is bigger. I didn't say that. And then I'm also thinking when they're telling their story, like, I'm glad I don't know that person. You ever had that? And then I thought, and if I did meet that person, I'm not sure that I would want to spend much time around them. You know, when you hear of someone and you think, not in a terrible way, like I don't love you, but in a way that I don't think that person's going to add any value to my life, and so it's better if I don't have a deep relationship with them. So that was one story. But on the other hand, it's probable that you've heard a few positive stories in your life. You guys ever heard a positive story in your life? Someone telling you about someone else and you think, man, I wish I knew somebody like that. Can you introduce me to that person? I have another friend who, she talks often about one of her family members. And whenever my friend feels sad or confused or overwhelmed, she can go to that family member and they make her feel normal. They listen to her talk and they sympathize with her. But they also remind her of who she is. So they hear her problem, but they also remind her about who she is. You know, she's a believer. She's put her faith in Jesus. And so they always bring her back to that, and they build her up. And after she's been with that person, those family members, she comes back more confident and at peace. And you just watch her. And she can go to, but what's really cool is that she can even go to them when she's joyful. So not just in problems, but even in times of joy, she can come and they'll celebrate with her. They will cheer her on. And I've known her for a long time. She's one of my really good friends. And when I look at her life, I think, gosh, she's so stable. She's so confident. And, you know, I think I attribute that in her life to some of those really stable relationships where she's got someone who builds her up. And when I hear her talk about them, I think, maybe she'll invite me over for dinner or something. Like, I really want to get to know those people. You guys ever have anybody in your life that's a friend or a family member or a friend of a friend, and you're like, I just want to know them like you know them. You know, I want a relationship like that in my life. Sharing your faith is as simple as telling your story. Sharing your faith is as simple as, and I'm going to tell you why. Because we all have stories that we can tell about people who have hurt us. But if you know Jesus, if you're here in the room or you're listening online and you know Jesus, if you've decided to follow him, you can tell at least one story of the positive difference that he has made in your life. Here's another cool thing. Even if you haven't said yes to Jesus, you're in the room or you're watching online, but you're just kind of lingering around church and Christian people and you're trying to get a feel for Jesus, this is really cool because you probably have a story that you can tell about what you see Jesus doing. You might not have all the pieces, and you might not be able to make total sense of everything going on around you, but you can see, or you maybe have seen, some sort of positive transformation, and you can begin to share that with others. You can share what you're experiencing with other people, even if you haven't said yes to Jesus. And so this is it. Sharing your faith is living and talking in such a way that draws someone else to say, wow, I could really benefit from knowing this Jesus that you know. Much like when my friend was telling about her family member, it's her grandparents. She loves her grandparents, and I do know her grandparents. I actually have been invited over for dinner, and I've got to spend some time with them, and I love them. And what's really cool is they love everybody the same way they love her. And so having been in that relationship with them, and so now I can tell some stories, but that's Jesus. We want to live and talk in such a way that other people say, man, I could really benefit from knowing this Jesus that you know, because it becomes a relationship. So I've talked with some people who've had this thought about how you share your faith, you know, how you share your faith. Sometimes we equate that to making disciples or getting people saved. And so that's what we're going to break down. Because I've talked with some people who have had this thought. I thought sharing my faith meant getting someone saved. You know, telling them how bad they are and working really hard to convert them, which is intimidating. And I don't want to do that. Neither do I. The truth is, I don't want to do that either. And what's really cool is I don't think that's what Jesus intended for us to do. I want to break down what Jesus did. So sharing your faith is not supposed to be malicious, and it should never be done with the intention of slamming a person or making someone else feel condemned. It also isn't pressuring someone into making a decision they're not ready to make. That isn't what Jesus did. We're going to look at that. The only people that he did, Jesus did slam people though, but the only people he slammed were the religious people. He didn't slam anyone else. And notice, when we look at scripture, he never pressured anyone into a decision. Jesus never pushed anyone into making a decision they weren't ready to make. Jesus simply invited people to know the God he knew. Jesus, the Savior, only invited people to know the God he knew. So I'm going to open up scripture, but first I just want to, you know, surrender our hearts to him. Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for your word. Lord, and I ask that you would minister to your people this morning as we open up the scripture and we talk about sharing our faith. Father, would you inspire us? Would you speak to us? Would we hear a word directly from you that would encourage our hearts? In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So if you have the YouVersion Bible app, you can pull that up now. There's also a few notes in your bulletins that you should have. And the scriptures are also on the screens. We're going to be opening to Matthew chapter 9, verses 9 through 13. And this is what it says. We're looking at Jesus. It says, as Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him. And Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. So I want to break this down a little bit. What happened is Jesus invited a guy named Matthew to follow him. In other gospels, Matthew is also called Levi, so it seems like he had two names. So Jesus invited a guy named Matthew to follow him. Now, by this time, Jesus had a pretty large following because he'd already started his ministry. He was healing people. So people were kind of following him around. So it wasn't super all that strange that when Jesus came up to Matthew and said, hey, Matthew, follow me. It's not that strange that Matthew would get up and leave everything because this guy had a large, Jesus had a large following. And so Matthew's like, you know, like you see someone really cool. You see someone really powerful and you think, I wish I was in their group. I wish I was a groupie. I wish I was invited to that table. I want to be there. That's Matthew. That's almost everybody, basically, who was watching Jesus, because Jesus was so cool at the time. And the things he was doing, the way he was living, the way he was talking was like, it was powerful. And so people were literally leaving their lives and following Jesus. And so think about, you know, whether it's an actress or an actor or a movie star, if they were to be like, hey, come with me. Be on the road with me, and you thought they were really cool, you'd probably leave everything and follow them. I mean, come on. So think that's Matthew. Jesus is so cool. So he gets up, and he leaves everything to go follow Jesus. Now, here's another thing. The culture at that time was very religious, very religious. And the Pharisees, it says the Pharisees came and asked the disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Now, the Pharisees were these extra super holy religious people who knew the law. They knew how to do everything right. And they were basically the stand-in for people, like, to get to know God. But the only thing with the Pharisees is that they looked down on everyone else. And they thought they were doing God a favor when they did this. So they would look around and boom, roasted, boom, roasted, boom, roasted. They would just judge, 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 always judging. The Pharisees never had anything good to say about anyone, and especially not tax collectors. The Pharisees were like completely set up against tax collectors, okay? And so for Jesus, who's doing a lot of good things, he's walking around, he's healing people, he's being nice to people, he's talking about God in a loving way, to call Matthew a tax collector who probably felt like he was never going to be good enough because of how the Pharisees had labeled him. For Jesus to call Matthew, Matthew said, yes, I'm going to go find out what Jesus is all about. And so then we see from the scripture that Jesus wasn't just with Matthew, but it says that Jesus went to Matthew's house for dinner. So this is really cool. Matthew invited Jesus over to, I think Jesus invited himself, actually. He said, okay, I'm coming to your house for dinner. If Posan was in the room, it would be Asian and delicious. Okay, so that's what brings him over there. And they're making dinner. And then what we notice is this. It's not just Matthew that Jesus has dinner with, but Matthew the tax collector, who is looked down upon by all of society, feels comfortable enough to have his tax collector friends and other sinners present with him while he's having dinner with Jesus. Okay, and then, so that's what's happening. There's a whole bunch of sinners and tax collectors and just the scum of the earth, according to the Pharisees, in one room with Jesus. And the extra super holy people, the Pharisees, show up at the house. Like, they have nothing better to do than to show up at someone else's house while they're having dinner and say, hey, it's crazy. It's crazy to me, these Pharisees. Like, what are you doing? Okay, so the Pharisees, who think they're doing God a favor, show up at Matthew's house to judge Jesus and the tax collectors and the sinners. Now note this, Jesus does not leave the place where he is, and he does not deny that he is with sinners. Jesus doesn't leave the sinners, and Jesus doesn't pretend like they aren't sinners. What he says, though, to the Pharisees, he quotes Old Testament. Jesus looks directly at the religious people, and he quotes scripture that they know, and he says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. In other words, he says, I would rather have you know the scriptures and know what's right and be able to obey them and still be able to connect with people who are wrong, rather than have you keep all the rules and look down on those who don't yet know what you know. He says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. You may have your life all together, and you may know all the right things, but if you're pointing, that's what he says to the Pharisees, but if you're pointing your finger at somebody else, that's not pleasing to me. Whoa! Whoa. So this is really cool because Jesus didn't condemn the sinners he was with, but he invited them to know the God he knew by sharing his life with them. So that, you know, when we think about sharing our faith, it's not a command to just get someone converted, and it's not a command to pressure anybody into a decision that they're not ready to make. Sharing your faith is also not a command to get someone saved. The truth is, you're not responsible for anyone else's salvation. Choosing to follow Jesus is a choice each person has to make. They have to make it on their own. This is what you are responsible, though, for. You are responsible to invite others to see what you see, to know what you know, and to do what you do. So you are responsible for how you present Jesus to those who don't know him yet. 1 Peter chapter 3, 13 through 17 says this. It's Peter writing to a church, and he says, "Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil." And so Peter, he writes a command to the church, and he says, yes, always be ready to share an answer for the hope that is in you. So he's saying, when you're in relationship with people, Peter's talking to the church, and he says, when you're out in the world and you're in relationship with people and people ask about the hope that you have, be ready to give an answer, but do it with gentleness and respect, honoring where they're coming from, not pressuring them into a decision, but inviting them to see what you see, inviting them to know what you know, and inviting them to do what you do. And so that way, if they have any malicious, if they have anything negative to say about you, it'll fall on deaf ears. Does that make sense? Because you're not doing anything wrong and you're not pressuring anybody. You're just, this is the life I've chosen to live. I've put my faith in Jesus and this is where I'm going. So if you want to go where I'm going, just follow me. Just follow me. Just do what I'm doing. So sharing your faith should always be done with good intentions. It should never be done with judgment. We should never share our faith with judgment. This is why, because we're recognizing that you have signed up to follow Jesus. And so as a result, transformation has begun to happen in your life. And so you're beginning to see things differently. And you're beginning to understand that the rest of your life is a journey with Jesus, where you're going to go and he's going to invite you to exchange some things. He's going to invite you to let go of your sin. But as a follower of Jesus, you should live with the understanding, here it is, that you do not have it all together and you don't have all the answers. And so we never share our faith with judgment because we don't have all the answers and we don't have it all together. And Jesus today is probably going to point out a sin that you have. And so we don't go around condemning other people for their sin. We live life saying, yeah, I don't have it all together and I don't have all the answers, but I am in relationship with the one who does and the one who is. And that's what we need to remember. So the point is, real simple, don't act like a Pharisee, act like Jesus. Don't act like a Pharisee, an extra super religious holy person who has it all together, but act like Jesus, who simply invited other people to know the God he knew. Now, opportunities to share our faith come in all shapes and sizes. And usually, again, when I think about sharing faith, I remember, because I've grown up in the church, I've been in church all my life, and so I've heard stories about sharing your faith, and I remember every time they talk about it, I'm thinking to myself, there's no way I'm walking up to someone and saying, hey, you know Jesus? Like, I'm just not going to start a conversation that way. And whenever I've heard about, you know, sharing your faith, it's usually evangelism, which isn't bad, but, and then I think about, you know, they talk about getting people saved in the grocery store. It's not my style. I mean, this is funny because I shop, you know, I shop at a grocery store. Obviously, that's where I get food. But I'll be standing in the grocery store line, and sometimes I'll remember those messages where it says, you know, get somebody saved in the grocery store. And then all of a sudden, I start to feel a little bit like, Do I need to start telling them about Jesus? Like, just really, I haven't figured out how to do that yet. But opportunities to share your faith, they don't have to be done in the grocery store with a stranger, honestly. They can, though. If God prompts you to do that, absolutely go for it. Because I've heard stories, and I'm like, that is incredible, because people are ready everywhere. And if you're someone who can get somebody saved in the grocery store, go for it. But if God hasn't prompted your spirit to do that, then don't feel guilty if you haven't. So in my experience, and in hearing other people tell their stories, most of the time, this isn't all the time, because there are exceptions to everything, and there's no one way with Jesus. But the invitation for you to share your faith usually comes from someone else sharing their heart or sharing their story with you. And so they open the door for you to come in and to start having a conversation with them. Matthew 11:27-30 says, "All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Here's the thing. Jesus offers a rest for people's soul like nothing else the world has to offer. And if you've started a relationship with Jesus and you are following him, it's probable that you're learning this. Life doesn't always go right, and life doesn't always go the way that we imagined it. We still face struggles like we have in the past, only with Jesus now the struggle is different, because there is a hope and a strength that wasn't there before. And that's what we have the opportunity to offer people in our world is, but my God says his yoke is easy and his burden is light, and there's a rest for your soul that I know you need. And so when people begin to have a conversation about their life with you because they are struggling or because they are feeling defeated, you have the opportunity to share a bit of your life too. And so that's the invitation to share your story. You don't have to respond with getting them saved in that moment. You know, I've had so many times where people will come up to me and they'll tell me about some difficult thing in their life. And immediately my response in my brain is, they need Jesus, you know? Not because they're bad, but because I know my God is bigger. And because I know my God can give them strength. I know my God can give them hope. But here's the thing. If I just try and give them Jesus right then, that's probably not going to work. And I say that because people who are opening up their story and they're in the middle of a struggle, they're usually looking for a quick fix. And so Jesus is the answer. But I think there's a better way to go about it than just saying, well, you need Jesus. Because it's a journey. It's a relationship. And so when we're just offering Jesus as a solution and not as a relationship, sometimes it can be confusing for some people. And so instead of trying to get someone saved in that moment, it's probably better that maybe you try and get together outside of school or outside of work. You know, if you're in school with them and that's where they told you about it, or you work with them and they're opening up to you, then say, hey, let's get together for coffee. Or, hey, why don't you come over to my house for dinner? Or, hey, my son or my daughter is playing baseball tonight. Why don't you come out to the game? And so you begin to develop a relationship with that person, and you invite them into your life because you have Jesus. And the more they get to know you, the more they're going to see Jesus and say, wow, I really want to know this Jesus that you know. And so you invite them in to do life with you. You invite them to see the God that you know. Okay? And then if the person, so here's the thing, invite them into whatever it is that you do and you initiate that deepening and strengthening of the relationship, because that's what Jesus did. Jesus didn't get any, this is funny, Jesus didn't get anybody saved. He didn't ever ask them to raise their hand. And he said, come follow me. I'm going to show you the God that I know. I'm going to invite you to do what I'm doing. I'm going to invite you to see what I'm seeing. He invited people into relationship. And so sharing your faith is inviting other people into relationship with you so they can see the God you know. If the person keeps showing up, if they show up for coffee, if they show up for dinner, if they show up for the baseball game, then invite them to church, because you come to church on Sunday. Say, hey, why don't you come to church with me on Sunday? That's what I do. Why don't you come with me? And so then they come to church on Sunday. And then you say, hey, why don't you come through a life group with me? You know, I met this great group of friends and we get to talk about things. And I think you'd have a lot of fun. Why don't you come with me? And so you invite them to go through the life group with you. And then when the time is right, maybe give them an invite card. There's a bunch of invite cards on the seats. You either sat on one or you moved it to the left when you sat down. And so maybe, and here's the thing, every person is at a different stage in relationship with someone else. And so maybe there's someone in your life and they're ready for the invite card. Your next step with them is, hey, why don't you just come to church with me on Sunday? Why don't you come and see what God is doing? Come and see this Jesus that I know. And so maybe the next step is the invite card. But maybe the next step is just, hey, why don't you come to my house for dinner? You know, you know the people who you're in relationship with. And you know where you're at in that relationship. And so the next steps can vary from, you know, just meeting outside of the place or actually bringing them all the way to church. Maybe there's someone in your life who has already opened up to you and they're looking for what you have. And so the next step is just inviting them into what you have. So here's some, I was processing as I was thinking about this. I'm like, okay, good. Yeah, I've done this. But there are some real roadblocks. Anybody ever felt inadequate when they're trying to get somebody saved? I don't even know if anybody in the room has ever tried to get anybody saved. But here's the thing. When that moment gets close, it's a little intimidating. I'm not going to lie. And there's a couple reasons why. So number one, feeling inadequate. When I feel inadequate, it means that I feel ill-prepared for the task at hand. And here's the thing. Feeling inadequate usually in my life tends toward procrastination. So if I begin to feel inadequate, then I begin to procrastinate. And when I begin to procrastinate, then I find myself in a stalemate where I'm just not moving. I'm not moving anymore. Anybody? And it doesn't have to be related to church stuff or Jesus stuff. Anything, any area in my life, if I begin to feel inadequate, then I procrastinate because I'm not sure how to do it. And if I'm not sure how to do it, then I just sit there and I just sit there and I just sit there. And unless I find some help, then I just stop moving. And I think a lot of times in our faith that happens because we reach this place where I'm not sure I know how to get anybody saved. And so we've never invited anybody else to follow Jesus with us. And it's really just as simple as maybe we don't know what we're doing or we're not confident in what we're doing. And so we procrastinate. So I've been a part of the church my whole life. And whenever I think about sharing my faith, my brain hears the phrase, make disciples. Make disciples. And then I think my brain thinks make disciples because this is the scripture that's always used. It's Matthew 28:19. It says this, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. I don't know about you, but when I read go and make disciples, I feel a large amount of pressure to get people saved. And then I immediately feel largely inadequate because I'm not sure I know how to make a disciple. Anybody in the room know how to make a disciple? What do you mean make a disciple? And I don't think the feeling to get people saved is wrong. And here's why. Because God really does care about every single person that he has created. I mean, God created each person. He created you. He created me. He created your neighbor. He created the guy you've never met before that needs Jesus. And his love is real, and it's big, and it's deep, and it's full. And his real desire is that each and every single person, you and me and your neighbor and that person you've never met, his real desire is that they would all be saved. You know, he'd rather have everybody live with him forever with joy and peace and love and laughter rather than burn forever with Satan. You know, his desire is not that. It's he wants to be with people. And so it's a good pressure to feel the need to get people saved. It's a good pressure and it's a godly pressure to feel that need. But my question is, what's the right way to go about it? How do we get people saved? So the question I asked is, how did Jesus make disciples? How did Jesus make disciples? The answer is this. Think if you've ever read the scripture, if you've read the New Testament, you've read the Gospels, this is what Jesus did. He saw things in people, and then he said to them, come, follow me. And he said to them, I have something for you. He said to them, there's a purpose for your life. There's one time where Jesus called a bunch of people, and at one time he had 72 followers. And it says he sent out the 72 to cast out demons, to heal the sick, and to raise the dead. Jesus said to people, I'm going to trust you with more than anyone has ever trusted you with. That's huge. That's huge. He sent out 72 inadequate people and said, I trust you. The creator of the universe said that to people. And then he invited them to do life with him. We just read about it. He said, hey, Matthew, come follow me. And then he went over to his house for dinner. And then Jesus welcomed every sinner and every tax collector friend that Matthew had. He did life with other people so that he could show them how he lived. Here's the thing. Jesus didn't invite people to get saved. He invited people to follow him. Jesus was after their salvation. He wants their salvation. He wants them to live forever with him. But he didn't start there. Jesus showed people love. He showed them empowerment. He showed them compassion. He showed them conviction. He showed them strength. He showed them humility. He showed them forgiveness. And people could follow that. They said, I can see a real person following a real God, and I can do that. I can do that. He was a real God with emotion. He was a real God with feeling. He was a real God with struggle, and said, and when, as he was living his life and he was inviting people to do it with him, the people around him said, yes, yes, I can do that. Yes, I can follow that. He answered their questions. He showed them how to pray, and he invested in them. That's what Jesus did. So the phrase make disciples is also translated and teach. And the original word used is mathetuo in the Greek when Jesus spoke it. And what it really means is to teach or to instruct. So when we read go and make disciples, other translations say go and teach all nations, baptizing them, and that makes so much more sense to me. Go and teach. Although, again, I'm not a teacher. You know, and most of the people in the room have never gone to Bible college. And you know what I mean? So, again, there can be a feeling of inadequacy, like, go and teach them what? You know, I don't know Greek. I don't know Hebrew. I don't even understand the Bible I'm reading sometimes. What do you mean, go and teach all nations? That's only for church people. That's only for pastors. But the truth of the matter is, it's for all people. And here's the thing. I have two small kids, okay? And when I think about making a disciple, I can't make them do anything. You ever tried to make a toddler do anything? You end up with a riot on your hands. A big one. Okay, this is true. Then this is true of, you know, because toddlers turn into real people. And so people have a will of their own. They have a mind of their own. They have ideas of that. You have a mind of your own. You have ideas of your own. You have a will of your own. And so nobody can make you do anything. In fact, when somebody tries to make you do something, our initial reaction is back off. We can't make anybody do anything, but I know this with my toddlers, I can teach and instruct. I can teach and I can instruct. I don't know everything, and I don't have the answers to all of life's toughest questions, but I do know a few things, and I'm in relationship with the one who knows all things. And so I can teach what I do know, and I can share what I'm learning. And the same is true for you. You can teach what you do know because you've lived life. You've got some life experience. And if you know Jesus and he's come through for you, you can teach truth that you have learned. And then in the middle of that, you can teach what you're learning. And the greatest way to win people over, to share our faith with people, is really just to let them see our process. When someone comes to you with a struggle or a difficult situation, you know, I'm so sorry I don't have all the answers for you, and I, you know, I can feel for you. But you can say, you know, I've been through a situation like this in my past, and this is where I was, and I asked God to help me, and God was there with me. And so I can teach you how to do that. You know what I mean? You invite them. People can see that, and that's so real, that's so tangible, that they're like, oh, yeah. They begin to open up to this Jesus that you know. So if you're in relationship with someone and you see potential in them, or you have a hope for their situation, because, you know, a lot of times we're in relationship with people and we can look at their life and think, you've got so much potential. You have so much in you and you just don't know it yet. Or they're going through something and it's really hard, but you have hope for their situation because you know your God is bigger. And for some reason, something stirs inside of you that says, don't give up on this. I'm not going to give up on you. You don't give up on this. And then you come into relationship with that person. You invite them to your house. You go out to dinner. I don't always want people in my house. I'm kind of an introvert. So if you're that way, you don't have to invite them to your house. You can go for coffee. You can go out to dinner. You can meet at a neutral location. The point is, if you see potential in someone, invite them to do life with you and then do what works. God created you. And he gave you a purpose and a passion, and he put that person or those people in your life. And so God's going to use you right where you're at to share your faith with them. We make it so complicated. We make it so complicated, and it's simply just think about your own journey with Jesus and how you came to know Christ. There were people involved in your decision. There were people who invited you to watch their life. And so you don't have to have all the answers. Just try it. Just try it and feel a little inadequate and feel a little unsure, but watch what God does. Here's another thing. The other one is fear of rejection. What if they reject you, or what if they reject Jesus? Because again, when we get to that place, it's like, well, what if they decide they're not my friend anymore because I told them about Jesus? And then here's the bigger kicker. What if, because I've had this fear, what if I invite my friend to church and they don't like it, and then they never come back, and then they never know Jesus? Anybody? Anybody? I've thought that to myself. I'm like, oh, I'm not going to invite them to church because then they're not going to like church. And if they don't like church, they're going to think church is God. And if they don't like God, like, weird things have happened in my brain. But the scripture says this, John 15:18-20. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belonged to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. So here's the really cool thing. If you are in relationship with someone and you're trying to share your faith with them and they reject you or they reject Jesus, that's okay. That's okay. You didn't do anything wrong. And so there's nothing to be afraid of. There's nothing to fear, because Jesus says if they reject you, they're not really rejecting you, they're rejecting me. And Jesus says if they reject me, that's not your fault. And so there's some grace and there's some freedom to be able to just be okay with that. You're not responsible for their choice. And here's a really cool thing. Again, if you walk through a situation like that, where someone kind of denies Jesus or denies the relationship with you, it will grow your faith. And it will grow your compassion for that person. And you will experience a glimpse of the heart that God has. And God will use even rejection to bring good things and growth into your life, because we serve a good God. We serve a good God. And so, really simple message today. The action steps are this. If you're wanting to share your faith with somebody, adopt a come and see mentality with people. It's not your mandate to get people saved. It's your mandate to invite people to come and see. Come and see. Invite them to a place where they can come and see. So if that's Sunday morning, hey, come and see on a Sunday morning. Come to church with me. Come see what God is doing. Or invite them to a life group. Our life groups are going to launch in July. And that's neat, because it's just most of the time it's someone's house. I think we're going to have like exercise groups. You can go to the basketball court. Like, just invite them to come and see in that neutral location. Hey, come and see. Come and see. Invite them again to the baseball game or to coffee. Adopt a come and see mentality with people, where they decide for themselves whether or not they're going to walk in faith like you, but you walk alongside them in the process. You decide to walk alongside them in the process, and you share your heart, you share your struggle, and you share what you see Jesus has done and is doing. I know I made that really simple, but that's it. Share your faith is invite them to come and see, because that is what Jesus did. So go ahead and everybody, if you would just close your heads. Close your eyes and bow your heads. And we're going to pray. And we do this just for privacy. It's a private moment between you and Jesus. And the band is going to come up, and some music will start to play. But don't let that distract you. Father, I thank you for your word. Lord, and I thank you that we have your word to look at. Lord, and I thank you that your spirit does minister to us. Lord, and sometimes we don't understand everything, but you're so faithful, even in the process of not understanding all things. And you're present, and so we can ask you anything. Lord, and so I thank you for the fact that you've invited us to share our faith with people. Lord, in Matthew 28:19, when you gave that command to go and to make disciples, but it was to go and to teach and instruct all nations. Lord, and I thank you that you've called each and every one of us to do the same thing, but it's not something that's intimidating, and it's not something that's so far out there, and it's not something for pastors and Bible scholars, but it's for every single person who you have called, every single person whom you're in relationship with. You've challenged us to invite people to come and see. And so, Father, I ask that you would speak to each and every person in the room. Would you open up their minds, Lord, and show them a person? Whether it's a person they go to school with, or a person they work with, or maybe it is someone that they have a relationship with at the grocery store. Maybe it's the cashier that they check out with every time. Or maybe it's the restaurant where they have the same waitress and they sit at the same booth. Lord, would you remind and just point out people, Lord, in our own lives? Lord, and then would you open up our ears to hear opportunities? Lord, when someone opens up about their life, would you ping us that's an opportunity? That's an opportunity. Invite them to come and see. Invite them to come and see. Lord, and then by the power of your Spirit, would you help it to be so natural that we don't have to get worked up about getting this person saved, but we just have to be excited about who our God is. Come and see what my God has done. Come and see what my God is doing. There's hope for your life. There's potential for your life. Just come and see. Just come and see. Father, would you give us that attitude? Would you give us this heart? With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're in the room and you want to give your life to Jesus, you want to start a relationship with him, then I want to give you that opportunity. Or if you've walked away from Jesus and you haven't been following him, you haven't been in relationship with him, but you want to reopen the doors of the lines of communication, that I'm speaking to you as well. So if that's you, either you want to come to Jesus for the first time or you want to come back to Jesus, on the count of three, I just want you to raise your hand. Nobody's looking around and I want to pray with you. So on the count of three, 1, 2, 3, if that's you, just shoot your hand up in the air and I'd love to pray with you. I'd love to celebrate what God is doing. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. We thank you. Church, if you just pray out loud with me, Father God, I thank you for your son. I thank you for your salvation. Would you teach me to do what you're doing and continue to point out my sin so that I can give it to you and walk into the future that you have for me. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We can celebrate. I like celebrating. It's church. It should be fun.